Good morning, Emerald City Comicon. I'm very excited to see you all here today. This is our first panel in the big panel room. We are at capacity of 3,000 people for our 10-year anniversary show. I am very excited and pleased to present the person you have all been waiting for the next 90 minutes, Mr. Wil Wheaton.
Thank you very much. Wow, the awesome hour is 90 minutes this year. That's so cool. I have a timer here because I build my sets to be like 40 minutes to allow for Q&A, and I don't know, I may have like 4 hours worth of stuff here, and there's a lot of con for you to see. So I can't believe there's 3,000 people in this room. The last time I was in this room and there were 3,000 people in it, it was when I keynoted the Penny Arcade Expo in 2007. And I didn't know there were 3,000 people in that room, which is really good because I would have wet my pants. And but now that I know that there's 3,000 people in this room, I just have to keep saying that number over and over again until it becomes an abstract concept that doesn't terrify me. A couple of notes before I get into my storytelling today. Probably the most important thing for you all to know is that I am releasing this awesome hour and a half under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share Alike license. So please feel free to photograph and videotape and share and mash up and do awesome things with this if you can. Just please apply that license to it and then let me know that you did something so I can see it. The second thing is that for those of you with children or for those of you who are especially sensitive to naughty words, I do my very best to keep this clean, but the reality is I go somewhere between PG-13 and R. I lean a bit toward R. Damn it, Paul. Paul Saborin is texting me ASCII penises because he knows that my phone is turned on. Oh, if you could someday have friends who text you ASCII penises while you're trying to perform in front of 3,000 people, then you will know that you are truly a lucky and a rich human being. So those are the important notes. Now, what I want to do today is find my water. Is there somebody from the con? Can I have some water? This is what I'm doing today. I have been very busy for the last few months, and I want to tell you about two of the things that I've been doing that have kept me busy, and then I'm going to tell you stories. The very first thing that I've been doing that has kept me busy since last summer is creating, producing, working on and editing a program for Felicia Day's Geek and Sundry YouTube channel called Tabletop. I'm so unbelievably excited about this show. I feel like the entire room down in the, like, we call it the celebrity ghetto, where we're like signing autographs and stuff. So these two guys come out, and they're a couple of tables down from me. These two guys come out, and every teenage girl and their mom in the room screams like the Beatles have come out. And I'm like, holy crap, the Beatles are here. Those aren't the Beatles. Those aren't even the Monkees. Who are these guys? So it turns out that they're the twins from Harry Potter movie. And it was kind of like that. I'm as excited for Tabletop as everyone else is for that. For those of you who don't know what I'm talking about a year ago, Felicia Day called me and she asked me if I would be interested in working on a show together. And everything that we have done together has been amazing and fun. And I said, yes, of course, I'll do something together. And she said, I'm starting this YouTube channel and they're giving me a little bit of a budget to produce shows and I would like to do a show with you. What do you think about doing a show where you review board games and video games and things like that. And I said, that sounds very interesting. How about a show where, oh my God, we play tabletop games, board games, card games, and RPGs. And my brain's like, oh, look at all these ideas. This is the thing you've been wanting to do for your entire life. And we invite our interesting friends, writers, artists, creators, actors, YouTubers, to come over and play these games with us. And then we're sort of reviewing the games because we're showing by example how awesome the gaming hobby is. And then we're also letting people who are big fans of people like Grant Imahara and Ryan Higa and Jane Espenson see what they're like, thank you, when they're, All right, okay, I see it. The thing is, if you were standing where I am, it's very hard to see the tiny little hole where the water lives. Just gonna not comment on that further. I'm not going to tell you what I have now named this little hole where the water lives, but some of you can probably figure it out. So I said, oh, this would be so great, so we'll do this show. And she said, that sounds great. And for the next couple of months, we developed this show. We took what I loved about Celebrity Poker Showdown and what I loved about Jon Favreau's program, Dinner for Five, and we put them together, and we replaced the game of No Limit Texas Hold'em with games like Settlers of Catan and Fiasco and Ticket to Ride and Alhambra and The Last Night on Earth and Pandemic and Munchkin. And we put together, we shot 20 episodes in 10 days. And I know you should be impressed because it was really freaking hard to do that. And the first episode of Tabletop premieres Monday, April 2nd, at youtube.com/geekandsundry. And if you want to know all about the show, you can go to tabletop.geekandsundry.com and you can watch a little video there of what the show looks like. I brought the DVD of the reel, and then of course I left it in my suitcase. Because I'm smart like that. I plan ahead and then I forget important things. I did remember to pee before I came up here today. So, thank you. I'm kind of proud of myself as well. So I worked on Tabletop for a very long time, and it was incredibly awesome and super, super fun. And I finished editing and locking everything right before we announced the show at WonderCon. I was working up until the day that we announced the show. So I'm real excited, and new episodes are gonna premiere every other Friday. We share the sort of time slot with Veronica Belmont and her show Sword and Laser. And on the off weeks, we're gonna have outtakes and behind the scenes shoots and maybe some interviews with game developers. I'm gonna do some live chats talking about games. It's gonna be really exciting. So I'm really looking forward to that, and it's gonna be great. So that is one of the things that's been taking up a great deal of my time. The other thing that came about very unexpectedly right before I came to be in Seattle is another episode of The Big Bang Theory. Evil Wil Wheaton returns in about either 2 or 3 weeks. I don't know exactly how the schedule is. Some of the funniest moments I've seen on the show are in this particular episode. That's all I'm going to tell you about it. But one of the things that I will tell you is that I spent, after the most recent episode of Big Bang Theory, Sheldon and Evil Wil Wheaton are now ostensibly friends. So there is a scene where we're sitting next to each other in a restaurant, and, oh, thank you very much. You're not gonna put it in the hole, right? Because then I'll never find it.
That's what she said.
I did spend an entire day sitting next to Jim Parsons, and that was as awesome as you think it would be. I have also concluded that Johnny Galecki is the most effortlessly handsome man on the planet Earth. One day he comes in and like sweats in a torn up t-shirt and just manages to look sort of like rugged and sexy. The very next day, he comes in like a tie and the shoes, and he's all put together. And Simon Helberg and I were like, why does he do this? It's rehearsal. No one cares. But he looks like he stepped off the front, like he stepped off the cover of Italian Vogue. So that episode premieres in just a couple of weeks. Because I've been doing a lot of this creative acting work, I have not had as much time as I would like to do creative writing work. As it turns out, I have only so much time in the day and only so much creative energy in myself to create things. And when it's being drawn out of me to be an actor, it's not really there to be a writer. So what happens is instead of sitting down and working out the 2,000-word essay about maybe raising my kids or doing something with my wife or some of the things that people who read my blog and my books are sort of accustomed to, I find myself writing these things that are ridiculous, that just sort of amuse myself, that a year ago I would have written and then never published because I would have thought that's just too ridiculous and stupid. So I brought a couple of those things today. I asked people who read my blog if they would just tell me, I was like, hey guys, do my work for me. Please tell me what you would like me to perform when I go to the Emerald City Comicon. And I built an entirely fan-developed set list. And then once that set list was completed, looks like this, I added to it a work-in-progress, unreleased, never-before-performed-in-public episode from Memories of the Future, Volume 2. It's a little raw, it's a little work, it's a work in progress, but it's got some stuff in it that is very funny to me, so I'm hoping it will be very funny to you. So, enough introductions, I will now tell you stories. This is a thing that I wrote for my blog just a couple of weeks ago, and I titled it, I Spent Way Too Much Time on This. This incredibly entertaining bit of spam arrived in my inbox last night. It says, Aloha, hail fellow! There is no reason to run wild if you have no erection. It's time to help yourself. Nash Morton told me for this link. You can just ask if you want some more of this. And then there's a link that I did not click. So this is what I wrote in response to that. I just want to thank Nash Morton, who I'm sure owns a yacht, wears the finest silk shirts and only the fanciest of pants, for giving my email address to his friend, who is so concerned about how many wild runnings I miss out on because I have no erection. Now, some of you are too young to recall a time when you could run wild just because you felt the need to run wild. It's true, they were days long ago. But in these modern times, if you do not have an erection, you are simply not allowed to run wild. I vividly recall the following recent scene. Me. Is this the place where you come when you want to run wild? Burly man with a Wilford Brimley mustache at the entrance to a place where men run wild. It is indeed. Aloha, hail, fellow. Me, oh, thank God. I felt a need to run wild, a compulsion whose origination I know not. And finally, I found the place to do it. Burly man. Fine news, friend, fine news indeed. Just show me your erection, and I'll grant you entrance to the place where men run wild. Me. Oh, nuts. The thing is, I do not have an erection at the moment. Burly man. What? Me. I'm ever so sorry, sir. If you could find it in yourself to allow an erectionless man to run wild, burly man, certainly not! We here at a place where men run wild stand for certain things. Me. But, burly man with a Wilford Brimley mustache at the entrance to the place where men run wild, chief among those things is an erection! Calls off behind an opulent curtain. Jenkins! Jenkins, come here! Jenkins, a young man who has an enormous and obvious erection.
Yes, sire.
Burly man, this man here wishes admittance to a place where men run wild. Jenkins, bully, turns to me. Show us your erection and be ready for the time of your life. Me, about that. Burly man, he has no erection! Jenkins, oh, that's a jolly good joke, sire, jolly good.
So if you will present your erection, I'll personally guide you through the curtain to a place where men run wild. Burly man. Jenkins, do you have an erection in your ears? I said this man here has no erection. Jenkins, forsooth? Jenkins faints. Burly man with a Wilford Brimley mustache who stands at the entrance to a place where men run wild. Well, I hope you're happy. You've given Jenkins a cause to faint. Me, I'm ever so sorry, sir. I merely wanted to run wild. Burly man, please leave. Me, may I just... Burly man, no! No, you most certainly may not! I bid you good day, sir. Come back when you have an erection. Perhaps you could pay a visit to Nash Morton. Me, fighting back tears. Yes, I will do that. So thank you, Nash Morton. I look forward to taking my future erection to a place where men run wild. I am forever in your debt, sir. Thank you. One of my early sketch comedy writing teachers gave extraordinarily useful advice when she said to our class, listen, what you have to do when you're writing sketch comedy, when you're performing improv comedy, is just amuse yourself. If you do a thing that amuses you, there's a very good chance that you will amuse at least half the audience. And the other half of the audience will be too embarrassed by not being amused to join in. And then you'll have an entirely amused audience. So I applied that as a philosophy, and so far it served me well. Let's see if it works a second time. This is called If RoboCop Was a Bad 1980s Sitcom. I wrote this on my blog about a week ago. Now listen, in this script, because honestly, when you title your freaking blog post, If RoboCop Was a Bad 80s Sitcom, the way you really want people to respond is not, oh, ho, ho, that's hilarious. Thank you for amusing me and causing a smile to grow on my face. No, what you really want is, here's all the ways you've offended RoboCop canon. Here's all the things you did wrong. RoboCop never said those things. Also, why does the sergeant talk like that? It's offensive. Ed 209 is the one who said that. Because apparently, putting the title of the fucking blog post as If RoboCop Was a Bad 80s Sitcom is too difficult for some people to understand. Internet. So I now present to you If RoboCop Was a Bad 80s Sitcom. I am easily amused. So earlier today, when my brain said to me, you know what would be funny? If there was a RoboCop sitcom, where he was always screwing up. Every time he did something, the other officers would put their hands on their hips, cock their head to the side, and go, RoboCop! And then he just shoots everyone. I mentioned this to Twitter. A few people quickly replied with funny ideas of their own, and then I got excited and I made a thing. It looks sort of like a script. Interior Police Headquarters, day. RoboCop comes toward camera doing that weird marching walk thing that he does. He stops in front of a vending machine and precisely turns to face it. Flash cut to the RoboCop POV. Through RoboCop's heads-up display, we see the nutritional information of the various items in the machine as he scans them. A can of soda has a mouse in it. A chocolate bar has traces of cocaine. And a bag of chips is actually a bag of fingernails and hypodermic needles. All that skips by so fast, though, the audience doesn't really notice it consciously. It just sort of Tyler Durden's right into their lizard brain. A crosshairs appears on the HUD, and it selects a bag of oil-flavored microchips. They're actual chips with a cartoony, smiling RoboCop drawing on the front. He's giving a thumbs up on the bag of chips. Back to scene. RoboCop puts a crumpled dollar bill into the machine, which spits it out. He does this 3 or 4 times. RoboCop, dead or alive, those chips are coming with me. Laugh track. RoboCop, accept my money. You have 10 seconds to comply. He tries to put the money into the machine. The machine spits it back out. RoboCop, I have ordered you to accept my money. You have 7 seconds to comply. He tries to put the money into the machine. The machine spits it back out. It falls to the floor. Laugh track. RoboCop, you have attempted to assault a police officer with his own money. You are under arrest. An older grizzled sergeant comes out of his office down the hall. Sergeant, RoboCop, what the hell are you doing? RoboCop, making an arrest, sir. The sergeant rolls his eyes and shakes his head. Would you mind telling me how you're gonna arrest a vending machine? Laugh track. RoboCop, by the book. Laugh track. Sergeant, RoboCop, you're crazy. Let me help you. The sergeant picks up the dollar bill off the floor. RoboCop pulls his gun in a flash and points it at the sergeant. RoboCop, you are tampering with evidence. You are under arrest. Sergeant, you can't arrest me, RoboCop. I'm your boss. RoboCop, you are under arrest. Sergeant, RoboCop, I ain't got time for this. I retire in 2 days. Laugh track. RoboCop, arrest, 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 arrest. Sergeant sighs. Ah, damn it, you're stuck in a loop. I'd better reset you. Sergeant starts to walk towards RoboCop, and the audience goes, oh! In my mind, this audience is the same audience for every episode of Married with Children. The sergeant puts his hand on RoboCop's shoulder. RoboCop snaps out of it. RoboCop, assault on an officer, use of deadly force is authorized. RoboCop shoots about 10,000 bullets into the sergeant, blowing him across the hallway where he hits the wall and slides to the floor, leaving streaks of blood behind. Sergeant, gasping, dying, yet somehow still alive. Smith's reference. Damn it, RoboCop! I had 2 days until retirement! Sergeant dies. RoboCop, thank you for your cooperation. I am not arresting you anymore. Laugh track and cheers. Dozens of officers rush into the hallway, stopping short of the grisly scene. They look at RoboCop, incredulous. RoboCop turns back to the vending machine. Your move, dirtbag. Suddenly, the bag of chips drops from the vending machine for some reason, startling RoboCop. He whirls towards it and destroys it in a hail of epic slow-motion gunfire. Police officers, RoboCop! RoboCop turns to the camera and innocently shrugs. Freeze frame as the synth-tastic theme music plays. Audience cheers. So the thing is, I've completely plotted out RoboCop the series season one in my head, but I'm probably not gonna write it. Okay, I know, I'm sad about it too. So, thanks, I'm glad you enjoyed that, so did I. This is a piece that was requested. These are all pieces that were requested. It's called, and by the way, this has the F word in it, so, you know. Really? It's 1929. We're going to go showing ladies' ankles to people. Woo! This is called Because It Will Give Me an Excuse to Buy and Own and Wear an Ascot. Last night, I was out having a drink with a friend of mine. Because we're both nerds and writers, our conversation steered into nerdy writer territory and dropped anchor. It was unseasonably warm, so we sat on an outdoor patio, one of the few that isn't rendered useless to me by an army of smokers, and we talked about the projects we're working on now, the projects we hope to work on in the future, and whether Pluto Nash is truly the worst movie ever made. It will come as no surprise to some of you reading this that this discussion about the worst movie ever made was inspired by some talk about The Phantom Menace.
You can take your midichlorians and shove them up your ass. And then apparently you'll be so full of the force you can use it to ruin my childhood.
If you count things like budget, he said, Pluto Nash is the greatest failure in history. It cost something like $180 million to make, and it grossed two. $2, I said, longing for the days when it was possible to see a movie for a dollar on a Wednesday afternoon. No, he said, $2 million. Side note, Wikipedia says that it cost $100 million and grossed $7 million worldwide. It's not as bad as he thought, but it's still an epic fail. Also, his numbers were good enough for On the Patio in March having a drink math. That is an epic fail, I said. Did you see it? He asked. I gave him the same look I give people when they ask me questions like, have you ever walked 15 miles across broken glass in bare feet? Or they say things like, how great was that movie Ghost Rider? Or this guy, Ron Paul, Ron Paul, Ron Paul! No, I said. You see, Hollywood and I have this agreement where it puts things on its posters and trailers that let me know not to see certain movies. It's like a secret code. I took a sip of my drink and continued. So it's like Tom Cruise stars in, and I know that it's saying to me, Will, just stay home. Adam Sandler does that wacky voice he does in every movie, and hilarity ensues, you think. It's just code for, listen, don't come to the movie, save $13. If you really want to experience it, just punch yourself in the junk until you pass out. An ambulance sped up the street. I paused to appreciate the Doppler effect. In trailers, it uses music. So if I hear I Feel Good or All Star or Walking on Sunshine, it's Hollywood telling me to avoid that movie entirely, even on airplanes. So you don't see a lot of movies, he said. I do not, I said. I took another sip of my drink. But I have this idea to record a public service announcement for people who do enjoy going to the movies. Wait, I have to pee, he said. And he got up and went to the bathroom. I checked Twitter, saw that my Kings had lost yet another game to a team they should have beaten. Although they won yesterday and the other teams lost, and today the Kings are in first place, so suck it, everybody else. Get it out, go ahead, go on. I'm sure there's plenty of you Canucks fans here. Go ahead, do it. I know, that's, you're adorable. My friend came back. Okay, so you remember those John Waters PSAs about smoking? No, he said. Okay, he's smoking a cigarette, and he's going on and on about how amazing this cigarette is. And then he tells the audience that they can't smoke in the theater. Because apparently that was a thing you had to tell people at one time. You had to say, hey, people in this potential fiery death cage, don't light anything on fire while you're in here. Thanks. I don't think I've seen that, he said. That's because you're younger than me, I said, and unconsciously rubbed my right hip, where, as it turns out, I have bursitis. Thanks, biology. So I want to do one like that where I'm sitting in an opulent library with rich mahogany shelves and leather-bound books, a roaring fireplace. I'm in a high-backed French chair. I am sipping a brandy. I am wearing an ascot. I know, right? Of course you're wearing an ascot, he said. Why wouldn't I be wearing an ascot? I replied, that's what I'm saying, he said. Any excuse to wear an ascot, exactly. So that's the scene. I'm sitting in it like this. I held the brandy snifter, straightened my back. I turned to the camera and I go, oh, hello theatergoers. I'm Wil Wheaton. Oh, I see you're familiar with me. I hope you're sitting comfortably and having a delightful evening. I take a sip of the brandy, savor it. The management of this fine movie house has invited me here to make a simple request of you before the film begins. I take another sip of the brandy and I smile at the camera. Oh, this is delicious brandy.
My face changes slightly and I get serious. While you are enjoying this movie, please, shut the fuck up.
My friend laughed and he hit the table with an open palm.
Also, please, turn off your fucking cell phones. You're in a movie house, for fuck's sake. You're not in your fucking living room. Oh, and I'm smiling through all of this. I'm very, very classy. Of course you are. Right, I know, I'm wearing an ascot. Yes, an ascot. Because you wear an ascot, that's what I'm saying. So out of respect for everyone around you, the people who got babysitters, the people who are on first dates, the forever alones, the husbands and wives who are here with their partners not because they want to see this film, because they want to get laid later tonight. Out of respect for all of them, turn your fucking phone off. Keep your fucking mouth shut for the duration of the picture. Thank you ever so much. Enjoy the film and have a lovely evening.
I leaned back in my chair and took a long drink. So that's my idea. You should totally do that, he said. Because it will give me an excuse to buy and own and wear an ascot, I said. I thought for a second and then added, oh, and maybe it would make going to the movies something I enjoy rather than endure. But really, he said, it's all about the ascot. Yeah, any excuse to wear an ascot, that's what I'm saying. We ordered another round, and then we talked about the movie Aliens. Thank you. I was contacted by the Alamo Drafthouse, and they've offered to produce that PSA. So as soon as I have time, we're going to make that happen. And it's going to be amazing. My wife is my favorite person in the world. When I was a little boy, I remember asking my dad, hey, Dad, who's your best friend? And my dad said, well, your mom's my best friend. And I was like, no, I know you have to say that, but really, who's your best friend? And he repeated that it was, in fact, my mother who was his best friend. And I'm like, okay, so I know. She controls the food and washes the clothes. And I can't think of anything else she does that would be good. But I know that she does. I know that she's responsible for those things. But she doesn't seem very fun to hang out with. She's mom. And my dad told me how, in addition to being husband and wife, they were friends. I was like 8. It was a concept I just did not understand at all. Like, who wants to be friends with a girl? And have your best friend be a girl? That was gross. But I totally get it. I mean, it only took me until I was in my 20s. My wife, Anne, is my best friend in the world. We are a phenomenal team. We complement each other really, really well. And I absolutely cannot imagine my life without her in it. And when I was younger and we were raising our kids, who are now grown and out of the house. Yeah, that's right. It means everything you think it means. We only shop for two now. When I was younger, I wrote a lot about raising the kids and what it was like to be a stepfather and the challenges inherent with that. And I realized that since the kids grew up and moved out on their own, that a lot of the stories I write are actually about this new phase of my life, where it's my wife and I just sort of like being friends and hanging out and goofing off. And here's the thing, you guys. We're in a mixed marriage, right? Like, I'm a nerd and my wife is a normal. Some of you may be able to relate. But since she got her iPhone and got access to like the technology that I've just taken for granted forever, totally becoming a nerd. She plays Settlers of Catan with me. She leaves comments on my blog. She plays games with her friends. She texts me pictures of our dogs being cute. She is embracing technology and admitting that she's a little bit more of a nerd than she thought she was, kind of one day at a time. It's rad. So years ago,
I wrote this story about Anne and me before she had really sort of like embraced the nerd side. And I never published it, and I don't know why, because it's funny and it's sweet, and it just sat in my drafts folder on my blog. And I published it maybe a month or so ago, and this is another thing that people requested. So I will read it for you now. It is called In Which My Wife is Nerd Adjacent and Comedy Ensues. Hey, I said to Anne while we stood in the kitchen last night, do you remember that song from Avenue Q, The Internet is for Porn? She made a gruff Muppet voice and sang, the internet is for porn. The internet is for porn. Porn, porn, porn. She stirred whatever was on the stove and she said, that song? Yes, I said, that song. I put my hands in my pockets and I leaned back on my heels, striking my famous, I'm so proud of what I'm about to tell you gesture. It looks like this. I ordered a t-shirt last week, I said, and it says, the holodeck is for porn. I smiled and I waited for her to join me in laughter. At first, all she did was blink. Then she frowned, like she was trying to solve a puzzle, which I guess she kind of was. Finally, she cocked her head to one side and looked to me like I had spoken in a foreign language, which I guess kind of I had. You don't know what the holodeck is, do you? I know that it's from Star Trek, she offered helpfully. I told her what the holodeck does, how the holodeck works, describing my best not to speak in geek, which as it turns out is very difficult to do when you're describing the primary functions and inner workings of the holodeck. So you see, I concluded, if the holodeck was real, everyone would use it for porn. That's why that t-shirt is funny. Okay. We looked at each other for a few seconds. I said, I can't believe that you've been married to me for 10 years. And this is the first time we've ever had a conversation about the holodeck. Yeah, she said. I don't know how we managed that. All right, this is a true story. I mean, these are all true stories, but this one is truer than most. That makes sense somehow. This happened recently. It's called Life Imitates Art. Or, I don't know much about brain scans, but I'll help you fix your computer. Really, was that a groan? Like, oh God, not this story. I don't want you to respond. I don't care. I was making a joke. Earlier today, I got an email from a Star Trek The Next Generation cast member who will remain nameless. This person is a friend of mine, so I've chosen the pseudonym Jonathan Frakes for the purposes of this story. Jonathan Frakes' email had been compromised, and I'd gotten one of the spams it had sent out. So I texted him, and I offered to help him fix it if he needed assistance. It turns out I have a little Wesley Crusher in me, I typed. Then I thought for a minute and added, ew, that doesn't sound right at all. I walked him through scanning and removing spyware and malware, mostly via text messages. This was hilarious to me because the text message alert on my phone is the original series Star Trek communicator sound. I wanted it to be the next generation communicator sound, but it's too quiet and I missed it too much. When I get email, it's Chewbacca. So now you know. If we're in a place and you hear that, you're like, oh, Wheaton's got email, so. I like to think it's Chewbacca saying in the Wookiee language, you've got mail. So everything ran smoothly, but then Jonathan Frakes was concerned about his CPU maxing out. It's using all the power, he typed to me. Then I swear to whatever God you believe in, this is true, he followed that up with, and I quote, I'm giving it all I can, Captain. I typed back, okay. Run a level 5 diagnostic and emit an inverse neutrino pulse through the main navigational deflector. A moment later, Jonathan Frakes replied, all done! It worked! Thanks for your help. Anytime, I replied. Then I collapsed into a fit of giggles. This was funny to me because we're two Star Trek guys with magnificent beards. Making contextually relevant Star Trek jokes with each other. More significantly, though, is that we did this using handheld computers that were inspired by the show we worked on 25 years ago. In a nice bit of poetic closing the circle, 25 years ago, I helped another Star Trek The Next Generation actor, who will be pseudonymized as Patrick Stewart, set up his first Macintosh 2 computer. It was an incredible technological marvel. It blew me away with its 256 colors and its 4 megabytes of RAM. And its 30 kilobyte hard drive. Megabytes, sorry, I messed that up. Sorry, nerds. It was an incredible technological marvel. It blew me away, and it had barely a fraction of the computing power or memory of my 4.5 ounce smartphone that I take for granted and regularly complain about being a piece of shit. I love living in the future. Just imagine that I have a top hat on and a little champagne. True story. All right. And an ascot, of course. I don't know, I'm a little worried that it might devalue the entire concept of ascot wearing if I was just like going out, putting on an ascot. All right, I am now going to share with you some excerpts from Memories of the Future, Volume 2. Now, for those of you who don't know what this is and why it's a big deal, which by the sound of this room is most of you, Memories of the Future is a book I wrote a couple of years ago. It is humorous episode recaps of the first half of the first season of Star Trek The Next Generation. It is told through my unique perspective as a fan of the show, a kid who was on the show, and someone who's sort of looking back on the show 25 years later. I wrote it with the sense that we would have if we were looking at a high school yearbook. And if you're going, because it kind of is for me, to be Star Trek was like my high school time, although I kind of went to Starfleet Academy, it's a little different probably than where you went to school. By the way, world, when I made my Facebook, I was like, oh, high school, Starfleet Academy. There's like 10,000 people who said they went there, and I don't know any of them. Liars. The first duty of a Starfleet Academy graduate is to the truth, and you are all liars. It took me a long time to report those profiles, but I'm glad I did it. You gotta stand for things, everybody. That's one of them. So,
Memories of the Future Volume 1 is a book that people seem to have really responded to and really enjoyed. The thing is, the first season of Next Generation is not very good. And that's okay, because eventually it gets good. So it is this loving, snarky look back at all of the really bad things that we did. And I'm proud of it, and it's something that I enjoy a lot. And I have been working on the second half of the first season for a couple of years. Thank you, one person who's excited about that. That actually means that the one copy that I actually sell is gonna have to cost like $35,000, sorry. It's all about responding to the marketplace. But I ended up working so much as an actor on Eureka and Big Bang Theory and Leverage and The Guild that I didn't have time to do it. And I was going through my work folder on my computer, and I saw, oh my God, this is like the first draft of this episode is finished. It's not completely there, but it's close enough that I think you will enjoy it. So this is. This is from an episode in the first season of Star Trek: The Next Generation. It is called 11001001. Or subtitled Bynars Go Home. It was originally aired on February 1st, 1988. Clap if you were born after then. Now get off my lawn. By the way, sorry about the shitty world you've inherited. We really did our best. It turns out that no one can stop the baby boomers. It was written by Maurice Hurley and Robert Lewin, directed by Paul Lynch. Stardate 41365.9. Synopsis. In what is the first truly cinematic moment of Next Generation, the Enterprise approaches and prepares to dock at Starbase 74. Where they plan to upgrade the ship's computer to OS 42.7.1, which is also known as Targ Leopard. It's an important upgrade. It features some new LCARS icons, moderately faster RAM access, and the very important beta release of the Stop the Fucking Holodeck from Killing You service pack. Picard says that he anticipates a glowing report from Starfleet, which immediately retcons half of the existing season. When he says that the ship has performed magnificently, beyond anyone's expectations. Two words for you, Captain Picard: the battle. It takes a little less than a minute for the ship to pull into the starbase, but it's so beautiful, I think we'd be willing to watch it at least half as long as we watch the reveal of the Enterprise in Star Trek: The Motion Picture. Well, maybe a quarter as long, since the entire episode's only 42 minutes long. Okay, so maybe like a 20th as long. The important thing is it looks beautiful. It is an impressive bit of special effects wizardry. Now, we know that the Enterprise is pretty big, but the starbase absolutely dwarfs it. And as the ship pulls into its parking spot, we get a sense of perspective that we haven't seen to this point in the show. People at the base stop working to watch as it cruises past the windows. Now, a lot of time is spent on what is basically parking the spaceship in the maintenance bay, but it never feels tedious or gratuitous. In fact, it reminds us that not only are we in outer space, but we're in the future, man, where the things that make Wesley Crusher weak and strange will be engineered away by the seventh season, just in time for him to hop in the Traveler's windowless white van and drive around the galaxy. On the bridge of the Enterprise, everyone is extremely proud of themselves when they dock without crashing, which kind of makes you wonder how often that happens. And Picard tells the bridge crew that they get a pizza party. He and Riker head down to one of the mooring tubes to meet the maintenance crew, and when the door opens, they see some strange-looking little purple bald guys, and holy shit, evil Captain Picard from the Mirror Universe. Now, this is only funny to you if you can see what it looks like. The guy that plays this guy, Commander Quinteros, is exactly Patrick Stewart. Same height, bald, same build, with a goatee. I don't know how not a single person involved in the production of Next Generation in 1988 did not go, maybe we should lose the goatee. Like, he's kind of like, we expect him to just go, would you come see my agony booth before the episode is over? I would like that very much. You born after 1988ers don't know what I'm talking about.
That's okay.
Enjoy your ever-warming planet, jerks.
Commander Quinteros looks at Captain Picard and he says, "You're late. We expected you sooner." Picard says, "Yeah, about that. You see, we got held up by this omnipotent alien who put us on trial for every dick move in the history of mankind. Don't worry, though. We nailed it and he left. You're welcome. Then the fucking kid felt strange but also good and took over the ship. No worries, nailed that too. Then we had some amok time, found that the Ferengi aren't nearly as scary as we thought, spent some time a zillion million bazillion miles away where thoughts become reality, and then we had to leave the planet of naked people who want to fuck everything that moves because the kid fell on some flowers. We survived a crazy Ferengi's blood revenge, and then again we got held up by the omnipotent alien. We barely survived a holodeck malfunction, and then we found and blasted into space the android's evil twin brother when he tried to murder us. But hey, Commander Quinteros, I'm really sorry that you had to put the dinner you made back into the oven to keep it warm right here on your nice, safe, never malfunctioning star base. Quinteros says, I had no idea. Riker says, everything you need to know so far is right here. I'm glad I went back to my room to get that prop because the joke paid off. So on their way into the Enterprise, we find out that those strange little bald purple men who will be working on the ship are called the Binars, and they're not actually men or ladies. Turns out that they're an androgynous unified pair and will be working together, which is probably good because they tend to start and finish each other's sentences. Picard and Riker leave Quinteros and the Binars to do their work, and this is where I have to break out of the narrative to point out something incredibly cool that I think you'd never notice if you didn't work on Next Generation. Picard and Riker walk out of engineering, and then we cut to find them walking through a different corridor on the Enterprise. But in real life, they're actually walking right back across the engineering set they left, which has been redressed. The pool table, two sets of consoles along the wall, and that huge graphic of the ship with the hamster wheel where the engine should be have been taken out. That's true, by the way. The metal and metal veneers have been put all over the engineering displays, so it looks like someplace entirely different, which I thought was really cool. Okay, back to business. Riker says that even though he's never met them before, he knows that the Binars are perfect to work on the computer because he read about it in the script. Picard tells Riker that he heard that the Binars are so totally BFF with the computer on their home planet, they can actually converse in a language that is like as close to perfect binary as organic beings can bet. Oh, also, as long as they're telling each other stuff that they heard about another guy, Picard heard about this one guy who sent the picture back to her parents with the caption, "Eating well at college, please send money." I know, five of you know what that means, and that joke's for you. Once they land in the turbo lift, they reveal their plans for rest and relaxation while the spaceship is in the shop. Picard says he's going to go turn on his personal relaxation light and lose himself in the pages of an old novel, something like The Canadian Mounted. Riker's going to spend his time off figuring out how he'll spend his time off. Up on the bridge, we discover our old pal Wesley Crusher watching the Binars work. He seems rather enthralled, which has nothing to do with him being 14 and the Binars being played by female gymnasts in their early 20s wearing skin-tight suits. Riker notices that there are now 0100 Binars instead of the 10 Binars he expected, and he asks them why. They're a little jumpy when they tell him that they needed to invite over some friends because it's a huge project and it's due sooner than they thought, and they're just burning incense because it smells good, man. Wesley observes that Riker doesn't seem to trust them, and Riker says that he's not sure that he does, but it might just be a little contact paranoia. Wesley then says, maybe it's just the way another species behaves. A remarkably insightful and intelligent thing for a 14-year-old to consider. Thank you, Usenet. Go fuck yourself.
Riker tells Wesley that he's going to go cruise around the ship, figuring out what he's going to do when he's cruising around the ship. And Wesley should keep an eye on things while he's gone. What? He's going to leave the teenager in charge? Well, hello, Dolly, Wesley Crusher. You have come a long way since Shut Up, Wesley, baby. All kidding aside, something feels different about Wesley in these pages. Maybe it's the pride he feels in his new rainbow spacesuit. Maybe it's the... That's pride with a capital P, everybody. You're welcome. Maybe it's the writers giving him intelligent and insightful things to say instead of the usual stuff. Maybe it's the actor not screwing it up. But he seems more serious and respectful than he has to this point in this series. Like, he takes the responsibility he has as an acting ensign on the bridge of a starship more seriously than we've seen so far, and it's a refreshing change. And I'm sure some Trekkies were getting ready to cycle their personal airlocks at the time, but when Riker heads out and leaves Wesley alone with the keys to the car, it doesn't seem as far-fetched as it would have, oh, the previous episode. So I'm going to skip ahead. Riker walks around and he sees other people doing other things, and some of it's and there's a and I make a joke about Worf yelling at kids. Dr. Crusher is all excited to go meet Professor Terence Epstein, who, in addition to being the leading mind in cybernetics, is also conveniently on the starbase, and he's teaching a workshop on giving the doctor something interesting to do during the episode without actually hiring an actor to play the professor. So Riker goes down to the holodeck. The holodeck's been repaired and enhanced by a pair of binars who invite him to try it out. Riker tells the holodeck to build a 1958 jazz club in New Orleans. The holodeck complies, and then there's this wonderful scene, visually and dramatically, as he customizes the band and the audience. He finally settles on an audience for one, a sultry woman named Minuet. While they get to know each other, we go, to this day, Frakes will go, Minuet. Like, just totally out of context. He comes to visit the set of Leverage. What are you doing, Shrake? What are you doing, Frakes? Minuet. What? You know what? Forget I asked. While Minuet and Riker get to know each other, we go back up on the bridge to find the, we find Wesley Crusher keeping an eye on the binars. He tries to ask the evil mirror universe Captain Picard a question about them, but he very suspiciously tells Wesley that he can just ask the binars himself. Okay. Wesley talks to the binars and he finds out that the funky sound they keep making at each other is their primary language, a method of speech so fast and efficient they have to store it in little RAM buffers that they wear on their belts. Wesley says that having a society so integrated with computers has tremendous advantages, which makes me think that Wesley remembers absolutely nothing about the beginning of the 21st century. And the binars tell him that it's pretty swell for the instant access to porn and sports betting. He says it does have a few disadvantages, like comments on YouTube and those FARC threads that don't have pics. And also when OP doesn't deliver. Picard has to wait 20 minutes or so before he can use his personal relaxation light again. So he comes out of his ready room and he asks Wesley if everything's okay. I know, you have to wait. That one catches up to you for a second. It's, go ahead, I'm going to take a drink and let you enjoy that thought. Wesley tells him that everything's fine, thanks. Wesley says, everything's fine, thanks. I mean, it's not like the binars are going to lock Riker and Picard in the holodeck, fake an antimatter containment field failure, and then take the Enterprise back to their home planet or anything. Chillax, dude. Picard says that's great news, and he asks where Riker is. Wesley tells him that Riker's in holodeck 4 and offers to call him for him. No, that's okay, Picard says. I think I'll head down there and cock block him in person. Speaking of holodeck 4, Riker's on stage playing with the jazz quartet. He eventually steps off the stage and he starts doing a slow dance with Minuet. He asks her how real she is. She says, as real as you need me to be. Before the fan fiction can begin, Picard shows up. Hey, Will Riker, what's going on? Picard says, nothing! Riker says, washing my hands! Picard gives him a knowing look. Riker introduces him to Minuet, who immediately starts speaking in French to the captain and invites him to join them. There's an especially funny moment when she walks away and Picard and Riker share a look that says, that ass. I know, right? They sit down at the bar and we cruise over to the observation lounge where we find Data waiting for inspiration. It looks like it's going to be a long wait, which is quickly interrupted by Wesley calling from the bridge to report a problem in main engineering. He wants him to come up and hold his hand, but they head down to check out the problem firsthand. Oh, Wesley, Geordi says, don't tell Mom and Dad that anything's wrong. Commander Riker and the captain. They're busy. Oh, Wesley says, busy doing what? Washing their hands. Okay, so then the antimatter magnetic containment field starts to deteriorate. The Enterprise is going to have to be taken away. It's going to go far away. They're going to drive the Enterprise far away so that it doesn't blow up and kill people, which would be bad. Then they go back. We go back. So everybody starts to evacuate from the ship because it's going to be bad news. So back in the holodeck, Riker and the captain are blissfully unaware that anything's going wrong. They've stopped talking to Minuet, and now they're reading My Pet Goat. As they enjoy Minuet's company, they begin to beat into the fucking ground how unlike any other holodeck character she is. Right, we get it, writers. She's sexy and insightful, and she knows what you want for before you ask it. Yes, she's just like a woman depicted in popular media in 1958. It's awesome. Could we please stop talking about it now? Oh, it turns out that they can. Despite Minuet's efforts to keep them in the holodeck with promises of dancing and wine and much washing of hands, Picard is determined to leave. When he gets to the exit and finds out that the ship is empty, at red alert, stolen by the Binars, and on its way to planet Binus, he is, what's the word I'm looking for here? Right, moderately displeased. Minuet tells them that the Binars programmed her to keep them in the holodeck, but she isn't programmed to tell them why. This is why you comment your code! So they head down to the holodeck to just get shit under control. Back on the Enterprise crew and a suspiciously unhelpful Commander Quinteros consider their options. All the ships available to go after the Enterprise are too small or too far away. Sadly, the USS exactly perfectly suited for just this task is on the starbase, but in dry dock for repairs. Data figures out that the Binars are still on the ship, and Wesley jumps up and says, oh, I knew that! I knew that like 2 pages ago. If you had just asked me, I would have told you. Why doesn't anyone want my help anymore? I've got a very good track record in this arena. Hello? Data wants to send a ship to Binus to intercept it. And back on the Enterprise, Picard and Riker go to the weapons room and grab some phasers. Once they are armed, Picard reveals his foolproof plan. Go to engineering and turn on the ship's auto-destruct sequence in case they can't get the ship back under control. Now, when they turn it on, it reveals two things. Whoever did the interior design for engineering on Galaxy-class starships had an affinity for late 20th century-style LED countdown clocks. And the starship designer placed the ship's doomsday weapon of ultimate last resort in only one place. It's probably the same guy who put all those isolinear optical chips within the reach of drunk teenagers in the Naked Now. All right, so having set us up the bomb, they head out of engineering. Neither of them is sure as, they look at a monitor and neither of them is sure what's on there, but they do appreciate its similarity to those cool 1980s Berkeley Systems After Dark screensavers. They try to run to the bridge, but velvet rope in front of the turbo lift and they're not on the list. So Picard, who is just full of clever plans this week, has another one. They'll go to the transporter room and they will beam into different locations on the bridge to surprise and confuse whoever's driving the ship. If they're lucky, they're gonna get a flanking bonus. And if they roll better than Jerry Holkins, probably gonna get an initiative round for free. What am I talking about? Everybody rolls better than Jerry Holkins. Moments later, they do just that, and they're only slightly disappointed to discover that there's just a heap of Binars on the bridge. They cancel the auto-destruct, which is also a little weird, because there's only one place you can turn it on, but then you can turn it off anywhere? Sorry, I get a little nitpicky. They discover that they're in orbit around Binus, and someone has activated that same screensaver from engineering on the bridge, and nobody on the planet is responding to their pings, text messages, Skypes, or IMs. Like, it's almost like their whole planetary computer is turned off and it's dumping data into the Enterprise's computer. Wait a minute, that's exactly what's happening. Of course, they don't just figure it out on the bridge, because that would be boring and efficient. Instead, they go to the holodeck and they talk to Minuet, who sings to them a jazz ballad about the binars, which goes something like this.
Well, way out there in outer space, the binars were a computing race. But they had to call the spaceship over because a star was going supernova. The supernova was gonna get all the data on their home planet. So they took away the Enterprise with a clever pack of clever lies. Now the Enterprise has a big hard drive, and it can store all of the binar jive. But there's a small problem, and this is it. All of that data's in orbit. Oh, there's another problem that you will see. The file was encoded in binary. And just what could the file name be? Well, I don't know, so don't ask me.
For her encore, Minuet plays an instrumental called The Binars Were Just Trying to Save Their Planet and Meant You No Harm. So Picard and Riker race up to the bridge. They figure out some way to get the Binars' data out of the Enterprise and back to the planet, saving the entire species. There will eventually be an FTP joke in this section. They're not sure what kind of file name to look for, so Picard calls Data at the Starbase for technical support. There will be 5 pages of technical support data here. Data says, "Have you tried turning it off and back on again?" Picard says, yes, he did that. So Data tells him to look for something simple, like a name or a place, which will be encoded in binary. Riker says, oh, I can't believe I didn't think of this sooner. Put in 11001001. Picard says, why? Is that because it's the number 201 in binary? No, Riker says. Is it because it's the binary representation of the RET unconditional return opcode for an Intel 8080 CPU copied in the Z80 CPU? No, is it because it's hex C9, which in IBM's EBCDIC equals the letter I? No, it's the title of the episode, man! It's been on the top of every page of the script this whole time! Oh, Picard says, a little deflated. Aren't you a little impressed by all of my oddly specific knowledge? Well, I would be if I didn't know that you just copied them from Wikipedia. Picard sighs, looks directly into the camera, and he gives future Wil Wheaton the stink eye. Make it so. Riker gets to work, but nothing happens until Picard remembers that the binars always work in pairs, so he joins them. A few commands later, the binars spring back to life and excitedly watch the data pouring back into their planet's computer. While they chirp away at each other in their binary language, Picard asks them why they didn't just ask for help from Starfleet. Because you might have said no, they reply. Which Riker observes as a logical thought process for a binary race. Now, in a weaker script, you just roll a die and choose one of the first 8 episodes of the season. I'll wait. This particular explanation would have been a little too neat and on the nose, but it makes sense, and for some reason it works here. They tell Picard and Riker that they trapped Riker in case they needed a grown-up to help them, and that they're happy to face whatever Starfleet's punishment would be. And, as it turns out, coincidentally, they are exactly the right size for one of Wesley Crusher's sweaters. Picard drives the ship back to Starbase 74, only popping the clutch once while going from Impulse to Warp 2, which is you know, not that hard to do because that's a tough gear to find on the Galaxy-class ships. Riker goes down to the holodeck to play the harp one last time with Minuet. Oh, that's a legacy joke that I cut out. I'll have to change that. He goes down to wash his hands with Minuet. That's what that joke should be, and I don't have a pen on me. Who sadly can't be recreated now that the binar's enhancement has been removed. Riker laments his loss to Picard, who replies, you know, Riker, back in the old days, first officers performed certain favors for their captains. The end. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
So like I said, a little first drafty, it's a little wordy. I'm going to punch up a lot of the jokes, but I thought that it would be fun to reward the those people who care about this with whatever ungodly amount of time you had to stand in line to get in here with something completely new and unpublished. So thank you for that. Hey, everybody, I'm done telling stories, and I have about 25 minutes to do questions and answers, which I understand is a thing that some of y'all enjoy. So there's microphones there and there. If you have questions for me, I would be delighted to entertain them. Why is everyone leaving? This is the good part of the what? Okay. All right. No, see you later. Oh, whatever. Have a good time. I know. It's a cheap joke. It's a thing we do. Don't worry about it. All right. No, that's fine. Go pee. I can't pee, but you can. Okay. So let's see. There's a person here, so I'll go ahead and I will entertain whatever your question might be. Oh, and you're cosplaying as Amelia Pond. Wait a minute, I know you. You gave me a Cape of Dicks last year.
I did.
Yes, that's right. The Cape of Dicks is hanging in my closet at home because I forgot it.
Well, that answers part of my question. Actually, despite having made you the Cape of Dicks,
yes,
I still don't know what the original joke was that led to you wanting a
Cape of Dicks. Oh, okay. Let me explain the etymology of the Cape of Dicks. The Cape of Dicks origin story. This is a point one issue, so it's not going to be written by the main guy that writes the book, but interesting continuity, I suppose. And it goes like this. So Chris Hardwick is one of my best friends. Chris Hardwick and I lived together when we were in college, and we have known each other ever since, and he's amazing. His Nerdist channel on YouTube starts on Monday as well, and I highly recommend watching that. It's going to be great. So he does a joke in his stand-up, and I don't remember exactly what it is, but it's something about how he could be riding a lion wearing a Cape of Dicks. And then a thing would happen. This is probably the worst way to tell a joke, I realize. And I promise you that Chris is significantly funnier than I am on account of him being a professional stand-up comic. But we were doing the Nerdist podcast at San Diego Comic-Con last year, and it was amazing. I kind of touched Karen Gillan's hand, and she kind of couldn't run away from me. And then Matt Smith was all, "Oh my God, you're in Stand By Me," and hugged me. It was amazing. And Hardwick and I were just talking about how great it would be to own an actual Cape of Dicks. And I said, "God, it would be great if someone would make me a Cape of Dicks." And you were that person. So actually, I would, you know, if someone wants to make me a cape of $100 bills, I would be delighted to receive it.
Actually, so question, the sub-question is, were there to be a Cape of Dicks 2.0, what features would you like to have in it?
Dude, Cape of Dicks 1.0 is perfect. I mean, it is absolutely perfect. I guess, I mean, it's, you know, when I wear it, I kind of look like Dio. It's like Dio in the cape. And honestly, Dio in the cape is basically Super Grover. I guess if Cape of Dicks 2.0 wanted to be more like a Cloak of Dicks, that might be kind of awesome.
See,
and it could
PAX.
Be an integral part of my Varys cosplay.
We'll see you at PAX.
I'm looking forward to it. Thank you. Are there any questions at this microphone?
Who is your favorite doctor?
Who is my favorite doctor? This is a question I am asked all the time, and I have to answer it this way. My favorite doctor is David Tennant. Having said that, Tom Baker is my doctor. He's the fourth doctor because he's the doctor that I first saw ever play Doctor Who. And there's an apocryphal t-shirt that says, "You never forget your first doctor." And Tom Baker is that guy for me. But I believe, I think that Matt Smith has done an absolutely fantastic job as the doctor. I love his take on the character. I have to tell you, the writing of Doctor Who this last season, there were some really great episodes, and I really loved the introduction of the silence. I thought it was inspired to have Morgan Shepherd play an older Mark Shepherd, because Morgan is Mark's father. But a thing has changed fundamentally, I think, in the storytelling on Doctor Who. Since the introduction of River Song, Doctor Who is basically 5 minutes? It's not 5 minutes. I have a timer going, you liar. It's 15. We started. It was your fault we started late. I'm taking an extra 10 minutes. So, don't make me assemble a nerd mob, because I'll do it. But since the introduction of River Song, who is a character that I love, I feel like Doctor Who has become less about we can go anywhere and do anything into a show that's more about kind of like the Book of Revelations. And I don't mind that. It's just not the show that I freaking loved when it was Tennant. Thanks for your question.
If you were a superhero, what would your name and superpowers be?
My name would be Captain Awesome. And I couldn't possibly be Sparks McGee. Listen, I thank you for thinking that I could be a tenth as cool as that real rebel Sparks McGee. But when I wear a cowboy hat, I look stupid. I don't have a tattoo. I do have a course you can plot. But I also don't, and I don't have a muscle car. None of you know what I'm talking about, but you do. By the way, there's a girl here in Sparks McGee cosplay, and it's maybe the most amazing thing I've ever seen. So my superhero name would be Captain Awesome, and my superpower would be going anywhere I wanted, anytime I wanted, making awesome things happen. Yes, sir.
Hey, first of all, thank you very much for doing this for 90 minutes.
You're welcome. Thanks for sitting here for 90 minutes. It's a long time to sit through a panel.
And the fact that you do free autographs means that you really appreciate and love the fans that you have.
Oh, you're welcome. Now, listen, before you think I'm supremely altruistic, I want to be really clear about something. I've got books. And for a long time, I made my living as a writer. And a number of years ago, I was going to a con, and I wanted to bring my books. And the con promoter was like, okay, you can sell your books, but then you have to charge people for autographs when they sign your books. And I said, that's bullshit, man. Like, that's ridiculous. Like, I'm sorry, these are good books, but they're not worth, you know, basically charging somebody twice for something like that. And I won't do that. And that sort of started this kind of pattern of doing things. So I don't know if it's going to continue forever, but that's definitely in force this weekend.
So yesterday I got you to sign a tub of Cool Whip for me.
That was very funny.
My question was, how do you take this poking fun of you and joking with you, Family Guy, Something Awful, things like that? Was it a learning curve, or have you always been cool with it?
I think it's really, I'm fine with it. I've always been fine with it. I don't know, I'd rather that someone makes fun of, when you make fun of something and you go to the effort to make, to do clever humor about a thing, it's actually quite moving. It's an honor. Mean-spirited, like, I'm trying to play Battlefield on Xbox kind of stuff, that's lame, there's nothing funny about that. But people who are like, I'm gonna do this clever thing that sort of makes fun of a thing that I did, I love that. And I feel really honored that anyone even thinks it's worth doing in the first place. And when I got that Family Guy script, it's really common in animation for something to be written, and then they'll write like maybe 10 pages more than they end up actually using. Things get cut out for whatever reason. And I had no idea what was going to make it into the script. And there's actually a lot more. It's more of a slow burn of Stewie getting angry at all of us and like really hating us as the day goes on. But I knew that joke was going to stay because it's a callback to Cool Whip, which is a Family Guy sort of staple joke thing. And as I told you yesterday, you're the first person that's brought me a tub of Cool Whip to sign. And the only other time I've ever made that Cool Whip joke was actually in the grocery store. I made that joke, and I held it up to my wife. And I was like, look, it's us.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, now I have 5 minutes.
All right, so, well then I'll try to make this as fast as possible and then I'll go back to being invisible. I actually don't have a question. I wanted to thank you because I was actually born in 1985. I grew up watching Next Generation.
Oh, that's awesome.
And actually at the tender age of 4, my first celebrity crush was on Wesley. Totally not lying. But at the school that I went to in grade school, liking science wasn't cool. And I was pretty
much... Yeah, welcome to America.
Yeah. And I was pretty much the only kid in the school who had a real interest in science stuff, and I caught a lot of crap from my classmates about it.
Yeah.
But every time that I watched Star Trek, and even... I wasn't able to recognize bad writing at that age, but...
That's okay, neither were the writers, and they were adults.
Well played. But every time that Wesley got to save the day using science and using his brain, it made it a bit easier for me to be able to go back to school and
say... That's awesome.
Say,
thank you.
You know, a kid can be smart and it's cool. So thank you so
much. You're not alone in that. One of the most amazing, wonderful things in the last maybe 10 years of my life has been meeting people who are roughly my age or maybe 5 to 6 years younger that grew up like you did watching Star Trek and sort of identifying with Wesley. And I can't even count the number of people I've met who are scientists or engineers or doctors or somehow work in the sciences because they were inspired by that character. And, you know, as an artist, all of us who create things, we want our work to sort of matter to people. I mean, that's the difference between an artist and someone and like a Kardashian, you know, like artists want to. All right, I'm sorry. It's gonna have to be the last question. He's giving me the no. I'm serious. That's the end of it thing. I'm sorry. Artists want to create something that challenges people, or that causes you to think, or gives you some sort of joyful distraction from your day, or gives you a world to explore, or something sort of challenging. Like all art should be kind of challenging in a way. And we seem to have really gotten away from that in modern entertainment, especially with the entire reality TV genre, which seems to be mostly about making people feel that their shitty lives aren't as shitty as these people who they're making fun of. Oh, who, by the way, are millionaires and laughing all the way to the bank. And they create nothing, and they add nothing to the world. And it makes me really sad because it's a waste. Like, that time is so unbelievably wasted. And I'm not saying that everything has to be deeply meaningful and every bit of entertainment you have to watch has to be super inspiring. Like, I love Modern Family, and it doesn't really inspire me to do anything. I'm glad that there's an intelligently written comedy on TV that I'm not on, you know, because I'm already on the other one. I am incredibly grateful. You know, for all of my teens and well into my 20s, I never heard from people who liked Wesley Crusher because they were the same age as me and they didn't have access to the internet and they weren't, they were kids, so they weren't going to conventions. And it took me a really long time to learn that when someone likes a thing, they just sort of go, yeah, I like that. They don't feel the need to go online and be like, I fucking like this, you know? It's like that comic book guy thing where he's like, I will be on the internet in 5 minutes expressing my displeasure. And it was an important lesson for me to learn. So I'm incredibly grateful to everyone who somehow cares about Wesley Crusher, cares about Star Trek, and cares about the things that we've done. And it's the other work as well. Things like the Guild exists because fans invested in it. And Without the Guild, I mean, I was friends with Felicia, but we never really worked together, and we weren't like close friends, and she's now one of my best friends in the world, and we're creative partners, and we do lots of great things together. Tabletop wouldn't exist without the Guild. The Guild wouldn't exist without fandom, and it's really important to me to say to all of you here and anyone else who happens to see this, thank you very much for making it possible for me to do what I do. And when you see these things that we create for you, and you let us know that they matter, it really means a lot. People will say, no, the work is enough. Those people are lying. When you're an artist, you create things for an audience. And if the audience is not there, then you're basically just a sad, lonely, crazy person. So we are all sort of sad and crazy as artists. But it's because I can come here and tell these silly stories for 90 minutes to 3,000 people that I don't feel lonely. So thank you for that. And if I could just leave you with a thing, don't be a dick.